Welcome to Module 12 of SQL Server Essentials for Oracle DBA. In this module, we will discuss backup and recovery. I would like to talk about the tools and backup types and types of errors and recovery strategies for recovering from various database errors. So first of all, let's look at the backup and recovery methods that are available in Oracle and in SQL Server. We will discuss some of the options that we have in SQL Server when it comes to performing backups. We will briefly talk about types of failure and recovery strategies for recovering from various types of database failures, and what, how we should formulate backup and recovery strategies for our database. So the various types of database errors that can take place include statement failures, where a single statement fails or transaction rolls back. Process failure, where either a background process or the entire server process fails and maybe disconnects your application. Instance failure, where the entire instance fails and crashes due to either software or hardware problem. User or application error, where the data is damaged due to a problem with the application or user action, such as someone accidentally dropping the table. Media failure, where you may lose the storage where your data is placed, so you can lose a single database file or the entire storage solution where your files are placed. And then finally, the network failure, where you lose the connectivity between your client application and your database. A good database administrator will take all those into account and consider them in formulating their disaster recovery strategies. There are two types of backups that are possible. You can divide your backups into logical and physical backups. So logical backups are essentially backups of the data. If you have another copy of the data in whichever form you generate it by using one of the import-export tools such as Integration Services or BCP, or by using replication, or just by copying the data to text files in any other way, that could be your logical backup. So that basically means you're copying the data rather than the database. Now, physical backup is a backup where you take a backup of the actual physical database files. So this is backing up of the database rather than of the data included inside. In Oracle, you can perform online and offline backups. In SQL Server, all backups are online, and they are consistent by default, thanks to the fact that the transaction log records are also included in the backup file. And when you restore from an online backup, your database is brought to a transactionally consistent state by rolling forward and rolling back the transactions that happened during your backup process. In Oracle, you also have incremental backups. In SQL Server, the equivalent are differential backups that have all the changes that were made to your database since the last full backup. And finally, the archive log backups in Oracle are equivalent of the SQL Server transaction log backups. Now, whether you take the transaction log backups or not depends on your recovery model. So let's talk about SQL Server recovery models for a moment. There are three recovery models available in SQL Server. And the recovery models basically define the amount of transaction logging and how much information is stored in the transaction log and for what duration, how long you keep this data in the transaction log files. They offer you control and balance between the amount of transaction logging and speed of certain operations and recovery options for your database. So the full recovery model, which is the default recovery model in SQL Server, means that all transactions will be fully logged and the information about all the changes performed by your transactions will be kept in that transaction log until you take a transaction log backup. In the full recovery model, it is possible to recover your database to any arbitrary point in time by performing a transaction log backup and stopping at that point. Another option is bulk locked recovery model. In bulk locked recovery model, most of the transactions are fully logged and transaction log records are kept until you perform transaction log backup. However, there are also operations that are minimally locked. Certain bulk operations, you know, bulk inserts, select into, also index builds and index rebuilds are minimally locked, which means only a minimal amount of information is locked about what happened during the operation. Only the information that is needed to roll back the transaction is recorded in the transaction log file. And no information that would allow you to redo the transaction from the log file is recorded. That means that you cannot restore that transaction log file backup to any arbitrary point in time. So in bulk recovery model, you still have to take transaction log backups, but you cannot always restore your database to some arbitrary point in time. And then finally, the simple recovery model means that transaction log records are kept in the transaction log file only for as long as they are needed to perform recovery on the database in case of the database or instance failure. You do not take transaction log backups in simple recovery model, and you have to rely on full database backups and differential database backups for your disaster recovery strategies. So the choice of the right recovery model for your database will be dictated by your disaster recovery needs and will affect whatever backup strategy you will formulate for your database. So depending on what recovery model you choose, you will have different backup strategies and different backup options available to you, and therefore various recovery scenarios possible or not. The choice is also generated or affected by the amount of performance that you need. So depending on whether you want to perform minimally locked bulk insert operations, you may want to go from full recovery model to bulk locked recovery model. Let me show you how we can change a recovery model for our database. So in this demo, we will locate the recovery model option for a database in Management Studio Graphical User Interface, and I will also show you how you can change the recovery model using a Transact SQL script. So, in my Management Studio, I will select AdventureWorks 2012 database. If I click on the properties for this database, the database properties windows has a window, an options tab, and in this options tab, we have recovery model. We can specify one of the three recovery models available, and this database is currently in a simple recovery model, which means it is impossible to take a transaction log backup for this database. But since I would like to formulate a disaster recovery strategy and a backup strategy for this database that includes transaction log backups, I would like to switch this database to a full recovery model. So I do this, and I can also script this change to a query window so you can see how this operation can be performed by script. So the option is alter database, set recovery full. This is how we can change my AdventureWorks database to a full recovery model. That way I will be able to take transaction log backups when I perform my disaster recovery scenario a little bit later. So in this demo, you've seen how we can change the recovery model for a user database. Now, there are various factors that will affect your backup strategy decisions. Actually, before you even formulate a backup strategy, you should probably formulate a disaster recovery strategy. So the correct order is to formulate what are your disaster recovery scenarios and how you would like to recover from various database errors, and based on that, formulate backup strategies. A common problem and a common mistake that people make is to formulate disaster backup strategy first and then retrofit the disaster recovery to fit that backup strategy. So what you really want to do is to formulate the objectives for your disaster recovery scenarios, and based on that, formulate your backup strategy decisions. So let's look at some of the factors that affect our disaster recovery and therefore backup strategy decisions. First of all, of course, it should be the value and degree of mission critical nature of data. Basically, you need to attach a price tag to your data. How important is the data, both in terms of the data itself as well as the availability of this data? How much it will cost us if the data is and the database and the system is not available for a given amount of time? So basically, it's what is the value of your data, but it also is what is the value of the time that you spent recovering from a disaster scenario. Also, availability requirements for your database. Whether your database needs to be available 24 hours a day, 356 days a year, versus maybe 9 till 5 only during weekdays, that will have big impact on what is your disaster recovery scenario and what is your backup strategy. Another important factor is the amount of transactions and the transactional transaction rate and the size of your transaction log in the database. How many transactions are performed in the database every hour? And how will that affect the amount of space that is needed to store transaction log backups? Of course, the nature of data access and how the application uses the data and what are the legal requirements for that data will also have big impact on your disaster scenarios and backup strategy decisions. The amount of space that is needed to store your backups will affect your backup retention strategy. How long do we keep this database backups, and therefore how far back can we go in time in order to recover from a major disaster or some serious database problem? Also, the backup should be governed by the cost of hardware and software resources that are needed to perform your backups and to perform your disaster recovery scenarios. It all boils down to what is the value of your data to your organization. So let's talk briefly how how Oracle and SQL Server recover from various database errors. When it comes to statement failure, both Oracle and SQL Server will automatically recover and roll back the transaction. So this is normal behavior, nothing really surprising there. If the statement or transaction fails, the database will roll back the transaction and issue an appropriate error message so that application can maybe retry this transaction. In case of a process failure, the process monitor and SQL OS and SQL Server will automatically roll back the affected transaction and kill the offending process without affecting the availability of the entire instance. So one of the goals is to handle any exceptions and make sure that one offending process or one failure is not affecting the entire instance. In case of an instance failure, SQL Server and Oracle will, of course, automatically restart, or the system will restart, and database will be recovered during the instance startup. So an appropriate recovery process will run on the database, rolling back and rolling forward transactions as needed. One of the more complicated scenarios, of course, is a case of user or application error where someone might have accidentally deleted or dropped data that is valuable and important in your database. In this case, your best option is to perform a point-in-time recovery. So using your backups, restore your database to a given point in time before that that problem occurred. In SQL Server, you will very often restore that database side by side or to another server and then copy the data over so that your main database continues. When it comes to storage failures, one of the options is a file-level recovery and recovering single file or single file group from a larger backup. You don't always have to restore the entire database. That could take a very long time depending on the size of your database. So SQL Server and Oracle offer the ability to pull a single file out of your larger backup and restore that file only. And in case of network failures, you have the ability to restore from to recover from those errors because a SQL Server and Oracle will discover that the connection failed and will roll back the transactions as needed. Now let's take a look at what are the backup and recovery tools that are available in SQL Server and Oracle. Generally in Oracle, you use the Oracle Recovery Manager or ERMAN to backup and recover database files. In SQL Server, backup and recovery is performed using backup and restore commands that are available in Transact SQL. You can use those commands from your T-SQL scripts, from your user applications, from storage procs, and from your various backup tools. SQL Server stores the history of backup and restore operations in a special system tables in MSDB database. Those tables are called backup history tables. It is also possible to perform compression and/or encryption of your backups. SQL Server offers native backup compression, but it does not offer separate backup encryption. In SQL Server, you can encrypt your entire database, and therefore your backups as a physical copy of your database will also be encrypted. However, there is no way to encrypt just your backup files. SQL Server does not offer this option natively. However, there are some third-party tools that offer this functionality for SQL Server backups. Now, backup compression that is available in SQL Server allows your backups to occupy less space. So data is read from your database files and it is compressed before being written to the backup file. This allows for not only smaller backup files, but also for higher performance backup and restore operations, since backup and restore are very often limited by the amount and capacity of the storage space. So they are basically I/O bound. If you compress the backup before writing it to disk, you have less writing to do, so your backup will very often take shorter time thanks to the fact that you are compressing it. Let me now show you a maintenance plans that you can create in SQL Server to automate some of the backup operations. So I'm going to create a maintenance plan using Management Studio and schedule this this maintenance plan for execution, for automatic execution using SQL Server Agent. In order to create a maintenance plan in SQL Server Management Studio, I go to Management, Maintenance Plans, and click Choose New Maintenance Plan. Oops, I have SQL Server disabled, SQL Server Agent disabled, so I need to start my SQL Server Agent first. Otherwise, the maintenance plans will not work. So one more time, let's call it AW 2012 maintenance plan. So this is a maintenance plan for my AdventureWorks 2012 database. Now, when I open the designer for the maintenance plan, one of the things that shows up is this toolbox. Let me close the Object Explorer and just show you the toolbox. This toolbox contains tasks that can be part of our maintenance plan. So let's check. Let's say I would like to check the database integrity before performing my database backup. So I'm gonna use this check database integrity task, and I'm gonna specify that I would like to perform it for the AdventureWorks database. As you can see, I can choose databases either explicitly, or I can specify that it should be done for all databases, system databases, all user databases, etc. So in this case, I would like to perform a database integrity check against AdventureWorks. And after my AdventureWorks database integrity has been verified, I would like to perform a backup database task. You probably recognize the interface. This interface is very similar to the Integration Services Designer interface we've seen earlier, because the maintenance plan, the maintenance plans are based on a specialized version of Integration Services. So I can, similarly as in Integration Services, I can specify the control flow and specify that after my database integrity has been verified, I want to proceed to perform a backup of that database. And again, I'm going to specify AdventureWorks as the database I would like to back up, and where the backup should be stored. So I will use the default backup folder in this case, and I will specify that I want my backups to be always compressed, and I do want to verify backup integrity after the backup has been completed. So these are some of the options that I can check here, and this way, using just a simple designer, I have created a basic maintenance plan for my database. What I will do now is I want to schedule this maintenance plan to occur automatically every day. So because we have it is now 3:50 p.m., I will schedule it to occur every day at maybe 3:52 p.m. so that we can see that it occurs in just a few minutes. Now, when I do this and I save my maintenance plan, what happens is my maintenance plan creates a SQL Server Agent job And that SQL Server agent job is scheduled for execution every day at 3:52 p.m. And the job, the SQL Server agent job, involves running an appropriate maintenance plan. And as you can see, the maintenance plan is actually performed by running the SQL Server Integration Services package. So a maintenance plan for our database is nothing else but a specialized version of SQL Server Integration Services package, one that performs maintenance plan, database maintenance plan operations. So let's wait just a few moments, and this job should run. So we can open a job activity monitor and see when my backup is executed. And you can see that, oops, for some reason it failed. Let's see why my maintenance plan failed. Could not obtain information about the user that is the owner of a job. So I need to change a job owner to be someone else. Let's use maybe the SA account. That should work. There we go. So I'm going to run this the job manually. And my maintenance plan is now executing. So it's verifying the integrity of the database. And after the database integrity has been verified, it should perform a backup. Except it failed again. So let's take a look at the history. No luck today with my backups. Oh, looks like we have some database integrity problems. That's the reason why we have four consistency errors in table production work order. So I need to check, I need to fix those consistency errors before I can perform a consistent backup. So let's say I would like to ignore those errors for a moment. So I'm going to modify my plan to skip the integrity task and just perform a backup database task. I just want to make sure that I do have a database backup before we proceed, even if that backup happens to have some errors in it. So I'm going to start this job again, and this time my backup should be generated in the backup folder of my SQL Server instance. So I have the backup completed, and in the next demo, I will show you how we can use this backup to recover the database. So in the next demo, I would like to show you how to perform a differential and tail of the log backup and restore a database using those backups to a particular point in time and make sure that all the committed transactions have been recovered for using those backups. So in my AdventureWorks database, I will create a new table. I already have a full database backup, and now I would like to make some changes to my database. I will perform a I will create a new table and insert 10 rows into this table. After performing this step, I would like to take a differential backup of my database. So I click on my AdventureWorks 2012 database, choose Tasks, Backup, and I want to perform a differential backup to a file called AdventureWorks 2012 dot diff. That's going to be my differential backup of this database. I can, in options, I can also specify whether I would like the backup to be compressed or not compressed. So let's say we will compress this backup, click OK, and the backup has been performed. So now I have a full backup of my database and a differential backup of my database that only contains the extents from the database that has been modified since that full backup was taken. So the next step will be to add some more rows to my newly created table. So I'm going to add another 10 rows to this table. And once I've added another 10 rows to this table, I will now perform a transaction log backup using transaction SQL command. So not using the maintenance plan, not using the GUI, but this time manually executing a backup log statement. I will give my transaction log backup a date. So it's 2012, 12, 19, and the hour is in GMT. It's going to be 15:57. So that's basically a timestamp that I put on my transaction log backup file. Run the backup, and as you can see, 16 pages from the transaction log has been copied into the backup file, and I have yet another backup. So now I have three different backups that I can use to restore my database to the point of failure, or whatever the point in time it is that is in, included in those backups. So I have a full backup that will serve as my starting point. I have a I have a differential backup, and I have a transaction log backup that I could use. After I perform my last backup, which is the transaction log backup, I will add another 10 rows. I now add another 10 rows to my table. So now with the 10 rows added in this table, I can see that there should be a total of 30 rows in this table. If I'm able to restore all the data in this database, I should get 30 rows in this table. So for now, I switch to master database. I will close those other windows so they do not interfere with my backup, and I can start a restore sequence. Let's assume for a moment that my database failed. Something went wrong, and the AdventureWorks database failed. I now need to restore it from backup. Maybe someone dropped the this table. I can restore the database by selecting tasks, restore database, and the restore wizard, the restore dialog that starts has information about all the backups that were performed from the backup history tables in MSDB. So this restore dialog actually knows what backups were recently performed against this database, and I can specify which of those backups should be restored. So the restore sequence involves restoring the full database backup, then applying the differential backup, and then applying the transaction log backup. As you can see, up here, I get this information warning specifying that a tail log backup of the source database will be taken. So basically what will happen is a new backup will be performed before the restore sequence starts. That tail of the log backup will include all those transactions that were performed since the last backup that is indicated here. So basically, everything that happened up until now, until I start restoring, everything that will be included in that last transaction log backup, known as tail of the log backup. I have the ability to specify a point in time that I would like to restore my database to. So I don't need to restore the very last backup taken. I can also specify which backup I am interested in. And I only have very few backups available here, and I don't really see the... I have the full database backup and the differential backup, and maybe let's say, that's better, when I show the hour. So this big dark green arrow indicates the point in time when the full database backup was taken. That's our starting point. Then we have the differential backup that was taken. That's this little white arrow. That's my last differential backup. And then we have the and then we have all this green area. This is the time that is covered by the transaction log backup that that I have taken. So that means that I can restore to that particular, to any point in time during that time window. I can also specify that I want to restore to a specific date and time, and then I can move this this thing around and decide to which point in time I would like to restore my backup. That also includes the tail of the log backup. So I can specify that I would like to, for instance, not only restore those three backups, the full backup, the differential, and the transaction log backups that are already taken, but also including the backup that will only be taken when I start the restore sequence, and use this tail of the log backup to choose any arbitrary point in time. So I can restore my data to exactly 4 p.m., for instance. So my database will be in a state that it was at exactly 4 p.m. So using this wizard and the possibility of restoring the database to any arbitrary point in time, I can specify the point in time that I'm interested in. If I knew that maybe someone dropped my table 1 minute after 4, restoring this sequence would allow me to restore the database to the state it was in right before the problem occurred. So now I could either run this directly, or I can actually script this operation to a new query window to see exactly what will happen. And what will happen is, first, the tail of the log backup will be taken. So basically, what is currently in the transaction log will be copied to a newly created backup file. And then we will start a restore sequence, starting with my full database backup, then applying the differential backup, then restoring the already existing transaction log backup, the one I have taken manually, and then finally restoring the last transaction log backup, the tail of the log backup, and specifying a special option here, stop at and giving the time where at which point the backup restore should stop. If I run this operation, I will get my database restored to the same point in time I think something is blocking my backup restore, so let's quickly see by using SPHU2, let's quickly see who is blocking my backup restore, who is using AdventureWorks. There's someone using AdventureWorks, and it's actually Object Explorer, so there we go. Let's kill session 60. The one that is using this, there you go, this database. So of course, if I want to start restoring the database, no one can be using that database at that point in time. So I needed to make sure that all the connections to the database are terminated before the database can be restored. And I run my script once again, and the tail of the log backup was performed, and then it restored the full backup, the transaction, the differential backup, and the transaction log backup, actually two transaction log backups, and restored my database exactly to the point in time it was at 4 p.m. So if I now run my query, I can see that all the rows that were in the table, all the 30 rows, were in fact restored. So that's an example of using the Management Studio and using Transact SQL to perform backup and recovery operations on our databases. So in this demo, you've seen how we can create a tail of the log backup and restore a database to a particular point in time using the restore dialog available in and the timeline available in Management Studio. Apart from the tools that are available directly in SQL Server for backing up your database, there's also a number of third-party backup and recovery tools and solutions that can be used together with SQL Server. Some of those tools include BMC Recovery Manager and HP in Data Protector. One of the very popular third-party backup tools for SQL Server is Quest Lightspeed and Redgate SQL Backup. Those tools generally offer additional functionality that is not available with SQL Server, such as, for instance, being able to not only compress but also encrypt your backups, or take backups, take multi-threaded backups, etc., etc. So there are these are additional possibilities if what is available in SQL Server is not enough for your advanced disaster recovery needs. So in this module, we have discussed different types of database errors and methods of recovering from those database errors. We have discussed various backup methods available in SQL Server and Oracle for both logical as well as physical backups. We've talked about SQL Server recovery models and how they affect your disaster recovery scenarios and backup strategy choices. We've also demonstrated how you can use maintenance plans to automate your backup operations, and how you can backup and restore database using Management Studio and tool and Transact SQL commands. We've also briefly discussed third-party tools that are available for backup and recovery solutions. Thank you very much for watching, and in Module 13, we will discuss basics of performance tuning.